Good. Okay. Well, welcome to the Leadership Lounge. This is January 2021, and we're here for the Leadership Lounge to look and investigate the power of purpose. I have two guests joining me today, and we are spending time together over Zoom as we're in the midst of lockdown. And I'd like to welcome my two guests. First of all, Joe Dedicote, who is the head teacher at Dale Hall Primary School in Ipswich. And we have Chloe Davis, who is the joint head of the Together Project at the Mix in Stowmarket. So welcome, both of you. Thank you for joining us and spending time together. So Joe, if we start with you, the head teacher at Dale Hall Primary School. So what is that all about? What's life like for you?
Well, it changes daily at the moment. So I'm head teacher at Dale Hall Primary School. We're a community primary school in Ipswich. We serve the kind of Witton, Castle Hill, Dale Hall area. And I've been head teacher there for 4 years, acting head teacher, and then substantive for 3.
Fantastic. So plenty of experience under your belt already, and plenty that, as you say, changes on a daily basis at the moment. And I know that you have some great insight around the power of purpose for today. Chloe, welcome to you, joint head of the Together Project. So tell our listeners, what is the Together Project?
So we're a project at the Mix Stowmarket, which is a youth work charity. So the Together Project is really, it started as a partnership project, and then we were really lucky to secure some funding, which is to help young people on to their next step. So education, employment, training, whatever that might be.
Brilliant. And again, your insight there, working with young people, helping them discover purpose, discover their next steps, find out their passions, will give us some great insight to help leaders as they listen today. So thank you for joining us. And as we've said several times, we each time we explore a topic in the Leadership Lounge, and today's topic is looking at the power of purpose. And for our listeners, I don't know if our listeners have ever actually thought about the importance of the power of knowing your purpose and knowing what your purpose can bring to you. But part of my role as a coach is to help people rediscover their purpose, because I believe that it has the great power to draw you forward as a leader and as a community. And this draw element is an acrostic just to help us understand purpose. So when we understand purpose, it will give us direction, resilience, authenticity, and wholeness. And we're going to explore that together with our guest today. We're going to be looking at how you find your purpose and how perhaps at times you need to re-find it as well. And where can we find our purpose? What sort of things will guide and direct us? What you do if you lose that sense of purpose and direction? How you generate purpose as an organization as well, not just as an individual, and how you maintain that purpose as an individual, but also that purpose together. So, Joe, let's start with you. You know, we're doing this session on power of purpose, but have you discovered your purpose? And if you have, what is it?
I think, to be fair, I think purpose is a really hard thing to define. I've thought about that question an awful lot since I've been going through my coaching as well. And the purpose of, sometimes purpose feels like a closed thing. So my purpose is to come in here and do this and then I'll leave and it's done. Mm. But actually, the deeper element to that is my purpose is what motivates me, what moves me, what gets me up. And if I think back throughout my entire life, I think it's always been to perhaps inspire and enthuse other people to do it my way, not necessarily my way. My first school report, I think my mum had, was Joe is brilliant at leading the other children. This was when I was 4 in the Wendy house, but she needs to learn to let other people take on leading roles. So I think my purpose has always been to inspire others, because I always have a kind of a power to do that. But I also want to aspire towards excellence, which I think brings people naturally along with me. So my purpose, I think, is about kind of awakening things in other people, getting to think about what they're doing, and to do that myself as well.
Yeah, brilliant. And I think this is really good for us to start off in the Leadership Lounge. Thinking about purpose is not just a job. It's not just my purpose is to be, in your case, a head teacher. But your purpose are these principles that you're driving. And you've talked about inspiring people, didn't you? And kind of helping them see things maybe they couldn't see before. So if that's helpful to our listeners right from the word go, just to see purpose as some principles that actually your purpose is your why and your what's that you do, like being a head teacher in your case, is how you then deliver that. But you could equally be delivering that purpose with friends, with family, kind of outside. So how did you discover that purpose? You talked about in the Wendy house. Was that where you discovered it, in the Wendy house?
I think you discover your purpose, and I don't know if you've seen the film Soul, which has just come out recently.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic film, and it talks about, are you born with a purpose? So is your purpose predefined, or do you learn it as you go through your life? And I think there are some things that are kind of inherent in you, which is, you know, I think I've always been a natural leader and people have wanted to follow me. But I've learned skills along the way that have enabled me to become a better leader. And my purpose is kind of fulfilled by the pleasure that I get from seeing other people accomplish things through my leadership. So, you know, I could organize a very good Wendy house when I was four, but that kind of went on to other things. And I think if I can show excellence in what I do, and I know enough about myself as a person, then my sense of purpose inspires other people.
Mm, yeah, absolutely. And I think this sense of discovering it along the way, and as you've talked there, almost it's about listening to yourself and listening to what kind of beats your heart, really, isn't it? And I was listening to something the other day, and someone was saying where you can find your purpose is where the things that you're passionate about, that will head you towards your purpose. And it's about heading towards those passions and listening and learning as you go along in terms of how you grow and develop it. And fascinating. You mentioned that film, you know, that the sort of spoiler alert for anyone who hasn't seen it, you know, towards the end, it was very much not about, you know, you have this one thing that you do, but this sense of taking each day as it comes along and just seeking ways to work out the values and the passions that you have on that day-to-day basis, and not confining it to just a job or a role or the thing you said at the beginning, I go in, I do that, deliver it, I come away. That's brilliant. Thank you, Joe. So Chloe, what about you? Your purpose, what's your purpose? Have you discovered that yet?
Well, I think I'm relatively new to the purpose game. I'm quite young still. Definitely didn't have one when I was younger. Felt very out of my depth. In that it felt like everyone else had a purpose and I didn't. So for a long time, just kind of followed what I enjoyed for a long time. Went to uni, did what I wanted to do, but with no real long-term goals. I'm not sure I'd advise that to everyone, but I went with it. And just fell into what I'm doing now. And I started, I think the last 2 years for me has been pretty kind of big in terms of development. And started to realise that I think support is where I need to be, particularly around young people.
So this sense for you, you've discovered this over time, and for you it's this support, particularly for young people. So bringing support is something. And so what about you? You talked about these last 2 years. How did you discover this then? Was it an opportunity that came along to be involved in the mix that suddenly just opened this door of realization, or slowly opened the door of realization? How it came together?
I think one thing I always say to the people I work with and the young people I work with is just going for opportunities and doing stuff.
Yes.
And following kind of, like you say, passions. And so for me, I went to university, I did English, which I really loved. But alongside that, I did a sort of a support role there, which kind of dipped my toe into it. And then I came out of uni, had no idea what to do. So got a job at Cabbages and Kings, which is the coffee shop at The Mix. And whilst I did that, I've always had an interest in the arts. So I went and worked as a youth facilitator, which is kind of youth did my turn to youth work a bit more as well, and then got the opportunity to be partnership coordinator for the Together project, so not youth work. But it became quite clear, like in the first couple of months, that I'd quite like to be a bit more on the ground and working with young people. And literally from there, so yeah, really kind of slid into it in a very bizarre fashion. And yeah, now starting to do some qualifications to try and kind of upskill, because I've realised that's kind of where I want to be now.
Yeah, yeah. So there's this sense that as opportunities came along, you took them, you saw what they could offer you, but also just allowed you just to open your thinking and realization around, oh yeah, so this is something that resonates with me, something I enjoy, and therefore taking those opportunities. So from your experience then, what sort of things do you think help discover purpose? So if our listeners are listening today and some of them might be thinking, oh yeah, I'd love to get involved in youth work, others are thinking, no, that's not for me, but what's the essence then that you've distilled that maybe we could give to our listeners in terms of if they're feeling like you were before the doors at the Mix opens to you, what would you say? Is it just about take each day and look for stuff? What is it for you?
Yeah, literally for me, it would be taking opportunities. Like I tried to get all the young people I work with just to do something and just follow things they enjoy. Even if they're not sure it will lead on to a full-blown career, that it will give them a couple of years enjoyment, and it starts to, I think it's just about learning who you are, isn't it, and working out what you enjoy and what does it for you and what gets you up in the morning, like Joe said, and I think the more you do that, the more well-rounded you become, and that's what starts forming it. And so yeah, I definitely don't think you're born with one. I think that you have to kind of find it.
Yeah. So it's this sense of just listening, learning about yourself and listening to the heartbeat again, isn't it? When your heartbeat rises, because actually this is something I'm getting passionate about, then the opportunities that come along, when they beat the heart more, then that probably is pushing you more towards those, that sense of what you could give your purpose towards. That's fantastic. Great. Thank you. So that's a good start in the Leadership Lounge. If we have a look at this acronym of DRAW, the first one is direction, that when we discover our purpose, when we begin to chip away, to open it up and begin to discover it, it can give us this sense of direction. There's this famous quote by Mark Twain that he's meant to have said, the two most important days in life are the day you're born and the day you discover the reason why. And I actually really love that quote, because for me it does highlight how discovering your purpose does give you purpose and clarity in life, a reason. And for me, a number of listeners will know that for me, my purpose is about inspiring and equipping people. I do that through a number of what's. I do that through coaching and training, this podcast, the book. But even in day-to-day conversations, that's how I work out that purpose. It allows me to work out also if there's an opportunity for something is right to take the direction of the business in. For example, I can hold up the principle of, will this allow me to inspire and equip people? And therefore, if it will, then it's maybe something that I can take the organization in the direction of. So it almost acts a bit like a compass or a filter to be able to work out that next step forward. So I think once we begin to know our purpose a bit, it can give us this sense of direction and journeying. So Chloe, what about you? Do you use purpose like that at all to shape what you do, either as an individual or in the organisation?
Yeah, I love that quote when I read it. I love this idea that it's a compass, because it's for me, like, you don't have to constantly be like thinking about your purpose all the time. Yeah. In the same way, you don't have to constantly look at a compass. But when you get overwhelmed or things get a bit muddy, you can kind of stop, pause, look at it. And then, we definitely use it in the Mix a lot. So obviously the Mix, a youth charity, so their purpose is to put young people at their heart and empower and enable them. And then we've got the Together Project is kind of, that's their basis, even though we're an employability provision. There's lots of employability provisions out there, but I think what makes us special is that we take the individual and they are the heart of it. We've not got other things in our minds. It's just their best interests. So I think that's what makes it such a good program. And then we kind of create lots of activities from the Together project. So myself and my colleague Sophie have been like on a real buzz to try and get things going and creating opportunities for people to get involved and get engaged. And even if it's at the moment we're doing an art class for young people that have got anxiety as a barrier. And we've also created a youth social action program to create community. So even though that they sound a bit strange for an employability program, we measure it against what we're looking to do, which is to upskill, it's to create community, it's to create passion, motivate. And it does all of those things, so it ticks that box. And so I think for us, it is just measuring all those things against our purpose, and then the mix's purpose, and that's when we know we've got an activity that's right.
Yeah, that's brilliant. So there's this sense then, purpose of the mix and purpose of the project then drives the actual activities that you do, and it flows through. And then if anybody comes in and says, oh, should we do this then in the Together project, you hold that up against first the purpose and the direction of that project, but also against the overarching one of the organization. Fantastic. So Joe, what about you? Does purpose help shape the organisation that you lead? Does it shape direction for you?
I mean, listening to Chloe, it's kind of exactly the same thing. It's about ensuring that children can achieve their potential and that they are constantly aspiring towards something. And it's about getting to know the individual. So listening to Chloe was really lovely, just hearing actually how, you know, one of the things that I wanted to do that shapes the direction the school goes in is to make sure that we get to know those individual children, that they aren't a statistic, they aren't, you know, part of our data has to look like this, because they are, you know, little people who come to us, and we are their primary, their first step into education. You know, when they're four, we're their first experience. And I want that experience to be as enabling as possible. So the direction that you go in is constantly shaped by what you believe in, and also by your purpose, because you can keep drawing it back to that. When you're head of an organisation or head of a school, or as Chloe is, a project, you have to keep coming back to that, because otherwise you will lose your direction. And it's so important to remember yourself in all of that, you know, how you enable people to do that.
Yeah. And just hearing you speak there, you know, whether it's a school, whether it's a youth project, whether it's a company that you're working with, you kind of have to know yourself. So what is the purpose here? Why are we doing this? What sits behind our reason? And when you know that and you know the values you want to operate with, then it should drive everything else. And to regularly come back to that, you know, I like what Chloe said earlier about using it, you know, as a compass. You're not looking at the compass all the time, but actually when things have got tricky and you don't know where on earth you are using the compass, aren't you? And it might be you just have a quick glance and then carry on, or it might be actually for the next 10 minutes, I really need to refer back to what we should be all about, and particularly when there are challenging times, which of course for leaders at this time, whichever organisation we might work for or lead, we are facing challenges, aren't we? There's a phrase that I use in training, which is purpose plus alignment equals shift. And that's all about that when you know the purpose and you can align people that you're working with to that purpose, then you get real shift, you get real movement. You'll either get accelerated or you'll get everyone pulling to it, and you get a big piece of power towards the direction you want to head in. And so aligning people to that purpose is absolutely key. So, Joe, you work and lead, obviously, a large number of people. So how do you develop alignment to that purpose in the team? Are there any top tips for our listeners on that one?
I think you have to be real. I do believe you lead by example, but you have to have integrity and you have to be real, and people have to believe in what you're saying, and that you're open to explore other people's ideas and attitudes and feelings and try to understand the reasons behind. Some people can be very negative over certain aspects of something, and rather than coming up against it, you have to look beneath it. But I would say it's taken me 3 years to align our staff. And what's wonderful is to see the alignment of the staff, but then the pupils and then the community. Mm-hmm. And if you take it back sort of when I first started to the way the community may have approached things, traditionally with a little bit of aggression, and how we approach things now, the alignment is, it's just wonderful to stand back and actually say, well, that's not how we talk to each other here, and that's not how we behave, and not anyone's expectation. So when it all falls into alignment, but it doesn't happen overnight. And we are in a society now, the one-click society, where, you know, you expect it to happen. You know, I want this to happen now, and I want everybody to understand what I believe in. Well, it takes time and stories and effort and getting to know individuals. And again, having time to reflect yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I use a phrase, I think we may have talked about this, Jo, fill the bath by the dripping tap.
Yeah.
You know, that you, of course, you can just give this torrent, can't you, of water. You can give a torrent of information and just think everyone's, right, I've told you, so now you should all be aligned. But actually, we know the bath will drain when there's, you know, and the bath water will get cold. And so we have to constantly refresh and replenish. It's where you've said, actually, it takes time to do that. And I love the way you said it takes story. It does. It's about us telling story where the purpose that we have for our organization is having impact. That's one of the things actually about the mix that I think is great is there's often story, people telling, the leaders telling stories about young people whose lives have been transformed. And therefore others hear that and go, oh, so this is what we're aligning ourselves to. These are the behaviors then that result in transformation. And again, part of that alignment for people is helping them understand what is our theory of transformation here? What do we think is going to make the difference, whether it's schools, whether it's youth provision, whether it's whether it's a business? What is it that actually makes success? And just regularly sharing that with people to help them. So that's great.
I also think you have to make every individual feel that they have a place. You know, it's not just about me, it's not about the person that the people that I work alongside closely, it's everybody. And if we all contribute, then we will have this wonderful thing to stand back at and look at together. But if we're pulling in different ways, that won't work. So it's understanding the everybody's purpose and worth and value.
Absolutely. I mean, there is this sense they need to know the piece of the jigsaw that they are in the puzzle, don't they? And that without them doing their bit, then it doesn't work. And we've lost a bit of the picture. I think you're totally right. I think that's quite key. Again, for listeners, if you want people aligned to that purpose, it's helping them understand their place. Yeah, fantastic. So our next one is R for resilience. And knowing our purpose generates a focus and a motivation that seeks to overcome every obstacle. Viktor Frankl, in his famous book, Man's Search for Meaning, in that book, he describes his experience in concentration camps during the Second World War. And Frankl observed that the people who were part of those camps who were most likely to survive were those that felt that they had a goal or a purpose. So this sense that knowing a purpose in this, being able to see through the tough and the difficult and the horrible and the plop, as I call it, being able to see through that and see a purpose or something that you can learn or grow from through it was a key thing to help. And so I'm intrigued for either of you. Have you found that purpose helps you to be more resilient? For those who are old like me, you can remember the phrase about the weebles that wobble but don't fall down. Chloe's looking at me. She's probably far too young to remember weebles. But Chloe, what is it for you in terms of purpose and resilience? Is there any relationship there? Have you either seen that in yourself or seen that in others?
Yeah, definitely. I actually Googled weebles that wobble. So I just made sure that I knew what that meant. I mean, definitely for me, I think I'm a real victim to a confidence crisis. So, you know, and doing the job that I'm doing where you're trying to create new things for young people and you want to keep it dynamic. When you create something, I almost always will have a moment where it's like, oh God, why did I do this? And the only thing that gets me or pushes me to keep going is the fact that I can then think there is a reason I'm doing it. There is a why. And yeah, that will push me through. And it also takes the sting off what you might perceive as a failure as well. You know, if something doesn't work, it doesn't matter. You've learned from it. And you did it for a reason. So yeah, for me, it's massive in terms of resilience, big time.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you. Joe, what about you? Does purpose help with resilience?
Yeah, definitely. I think you know that I have difficulties with the word resilience because it always makes me think of something like a marathon runner or, you know, that you get knocked down and you get up again and you've got this kind of, you know, nothing will pull you down. But I don't believe resilience is that. I think for me, being resilient is about, like Chloe said, you know, keeping going and keeping that purpose ahead of you so that if it doesn't work out, it's not seen as a failure. It's seen as something to learn from. Mm. And keeping your purpose there at all times. And I've written down actually focus, because you can lose your focus. And being a resilient person is focusing on that all of the time. You know, this is my purpose. I know why I set out to do this. It might not have worked out as I wanted it to, but my focus is still there. So resilience isn't something that I see as strength as much as being able to have the strength of the conviction in what you want to do.
Yeah, yeah. And there's this sense, isn't there, that resilience should be about how we grow and learn through it. Because you just say, it won't be that we don't get knocked over or we don't get battered. We will get that. But it's how can I learn? And I've almost got this image in my mind that we have like this satchel over us and, you know, because we have this purpose and direction, anything that we throw at it's thrown at us, we almost take bits from it that are useful and put it in our satchel of usefulness to make us bigger and stronger and better and help us thrive through it in order to help towards that purpose. So, yeah, there's this sense that it won't stop things happening. It isn't that, but it will. Hopefully we can grow from it. But because we've got this purpose aligned to it, that's what helps us strive forward. So what about this impact of losing a sense of purpose, though? So, you know, some of our listeners will go, great, I've still got to discover a bit of purpose. Some will go, yeah, I think I know my purpose, like you guys have talked about. But what about losing that sense of purpose? Can it be lost? Have you ever experienced that? And what's the impact of that? Chloe, what about you? You know, you talked earlier about, I've just started this journey. Have you lost it? Have you seen others lose it? If they have, what's the impact of that?
So luckily I've not lost it yet. I mean, that would be quite impressive. I'd question if it actually was a purpose. I've not really seen people lose it. I can only speak from not having had it and what that feels like. And that does, it just feels like you can't plan for the future or you can't see that far ahead. For me, when I was younger, it was literally just seeing one academic year at a time, and then uni, and then not knowing what I wanted to do after uni, so doing a master's because I knew I could do that. And then, yeah, the real crisis was post-master's and having no idea and applying for roles. And I think there's a lot to be said if you don't have real passion and purpose when you're applying for roles. That is obvious. You know, and you're probably not applying for the right roles, so you're not getting very good responses. Which is why I just totally, in the end, just was like, that's it. I'm just going to give myself a break, recharge, see what happens. And then I started to get more successful because I was genuinely interested in the things I was going for. Started. It's only in the last couple of years where I've started to think, okay, well, what would I like to do in 10 years time? Or where do I see myself going? Or actually, this is really exciting. I could actually be going like into a career, which never ever seemed like a prospect to me. It always felt like I was going to either settle for something and not be fulfilled, or just could only ever see 1 year at a time. So that's what I can speak from. But yeah, luckily, Not yet lost it.
But I think there's a real interesting nugget in what you've talked about there. You said, I just kind of gave myself a break. I just kind of paused and stopped and gave myself a break from having to think and intensely sort it out. So I think there's a nugget there for people that if people feel they've either lost it a bit or are still trying to discover it, is sometimes actually just to stop, take a break from it, leave it, try something else, and then come back to it later. Is probably quite a useful thing for people to reflect on as well. So thank you, Chloe. Joe, what about you and this purpose, losing a sense of purpose? Have you come across that? Have you seen the impact of that?
Not until about 4 months ago. I was a bit like Chloe growing up. I knew I would sort of fall into something that I loved because I had purpose. I've never not had purpose until about 4 months ago. And it was absolutely the most terrifying thing ever. Waking up and thinking, I don't know what the purpose is anymore. And I don't know what I'm doing anymore. And I don't even know if I want to do what I'm doing anymore. And it turned into kind of like a blind panic, to be honest. And they say you're kind of frozen with fear. And that's what happens. You know, you just kind of think, I'm a head teacher of a school, got 420 children, 70 staff. We're in the midst of a pandemic. Let's not forget that. And everybody's looking at me, you know, you're kind of, I'm a strong, decisive leader. And all of a sudden, I actually don't know what my purpose is anymore. And all my drivers are kind of gone, which was actually a blessing now, but it was quite a frightening place to be. So, Chloe, you probably have to submit data and statistics and everything else to back up how well your project is going and things. But that kind of all went away. And I just kind of found myself in the middle of nowhere in a really, really dark place. And so the way I got over that was I asked for help. And I turned to somebody I trusted and rang them up and said, I don't really know what's going on here. I can't see what to do. Do you know what to do? And pointed me in the direction of getting some coaching, which I'd always resisted. Because I felt it was going to be something like a life coach, sounded a little bit too like reliant on somebody, or, you know, a coach is someone that pushes you to your limits or makes you run further than you think, you know. And I thought, I don't have the energy to do that. I literally don't have any energy. I have no vision. I've got nothing left to give. So, but this person was very persistent and said, just try it, you know. And the first session that I had was transformational, really, because the panic started to subside and I could breathe. And then I suddenly realized my purpose was there. You know, it hadn't gone anywhere, but I thought it had. And I thought, how can I be in this place where I don't know what I'm doing? And then taking that breath and that time to reflect and think, actually, why did I start this? Why did I become a teacher? And why did I want to work with children? Taking it all the way back to those values enabled me to see again, really. And it took 2 hours of real kind of self-reflection. But the fact was, I was lost, completely lost. So I think the purpose is very strong now. I don't think I'll lose it again. So, you know, I think for anybody out there, I would definitely say if you feel like your purpose is fading, don't wait till you get to the point where I am, which is just kind of sat in a dark room thinking, what on earth is going on? Reach out, talk to other colleagues, ask somebody else, you know, what's worked for you, and establish what your purpose is. Because, you know, with all the things that are going on at the moment, everything else can crowd out those central feelings of you know, why am I doing this? And it's a choice. Nobody is forcing you. You have to remember this is a choice that you made. This is what, you know, makes you feel passionate about what you do. So, you know, ask for help, open up and do a bit of self-reflection.
Yeah, fantastic. Joe, thank you for sharing that story. I think one of the things for us as leaders and as human beings is an importance of honesty and just being real with one another. And I think your story there is really powerful for any leaders listening that are maybe wrestling with this or struggling with this. And, you know, you mentioned that P word, the pandemic, you know, it is causing us to have to reflect on things. It's causing changes, and this can unsettle. And your honesty there of just saying, actually just take time, stop and ask for help and spend time reflecting. And I think it's really useful what you said there as well, that actually it was still there. And chances are it is still there for other people too, but it's just seeing it through the fog of stuff. And our purpose is so important. It's like the coat hanger, the coat hangs off. And if you've lost the coat hanger, it's hard to know, well, so what should I be doing then?
But it seems so complicated when you've lost it. It really does. And it's terrifying, because if everybody's relying on you and everybody's kind of on your boat, as I said to you before, you know, and they're all looking at me and they're going, well, where do we go now? You know, I've built this trusting relationship with people. They know I'm authentic. I have integrity. We're all on this. Where do we go now, Joe? And I'm there going, I have absolutely no idea. But obviously you can't say that. and it is terrifying. You really don't know what to do. So I would definitely say it is there. You have just got so much around you that's preventing you from seeing it. And, you know, I chose coaching, or coaching chose me, and that's enabled me to grow massively. And I'm really glad it happened.
Yeah. And I think, you know, you're talking about the power of coaching there. And obviously as a coach, I would recommend it, but it's because somebody else can see with some clarity at that point that maybe you can't, and a good coach will help you just peel back some of those layers in order for you to find that clarity again. So yeah, thank you for sharing that, Joe. And for any of our listeners, consider coaching if your thinking is in that position too. Joe, interestingly, just mentioned the word authenticity. So that's a really nice lead-in to lead us on to our third letter in draw, which is authenticity. And Aristotle said, knowing yourself is the beginning of all wisdom. So there's another great quote from a great thinker. And for me, a key part of that knowing yourself, you know, Chloe talked about this earlier about knowing yourself too. A key part of that is about your purpose. So when you know elements of purpose and your passions and the things that excite you and makes your heart beat, what that can do is it can generate in you a kind of values-based life. It develops our integrity and encourages others to trust us. You know, Joe, you talked about that just now in the relationship. So have either of you experienced that actually by beginning to know this sense of purpose, it's generated an authenticity in yourself? It's allowed you to just know yourself a bit better? Chloe, what about you? Has it been any contributor, or am I talking nonsense? Feel free to tell me. No, that's not.
No, you're definitely not. I read this and I thought, okay, I hadn't thought about that one. Like direction and motivation and resilience, that made sense to me. And I thought authenticity, if I can say the word, that doesn't make sense. And then I thought about it, and I thought, well, actually, in the last year, I think I've been most myself, or like particularly at work, most authentically me, because I've had to. Because to actually fulfill the purpose and to do the job I'm doing, I've had to open up to my team. I've had to be real with them. I've been the most vulnerable I've ever been, which is an uncomfortable place to be, but definitely one that I'm learning you grow from. Yeah, I wouldn't have said that at the start of the year, but 100% I've realised, you know, my team are my absolute best resource. And for, you know, because of all of that, I have definitely been my most authentic with them. And then I've also started to put that into the relationships I have with the young people I work with as well. Starting to realize that it's okay for me to be authentic, and because I want to celebrate them being authentic. So it's massively hypocritical not to reflect that back to them. So yeah, I think it was one I'd not thought about at all. And yet when I started to delve, realized that they do come hand in hand, and they have to.
And it's interesting you're talking about going back again to the purpose of the mix, which is youth-centered, and the importance of the young person. And you just talked about, well, if we want young people to be authentic, then we have to model that too. So therefore, that purpose has shaped you being authentic, because you need to be authentic in order to encourage that in the young people. So yeah, that's a fantastic example. Joe, what about you? Is there any resonance for you in this? Knowing your purpose helps you discover yourself and create, you know, perhaps more of your values as part of that?
I think that was what I feared I maybe had lost. When I lost my purpose, I didn't feel like I was authentic anymore, you know, in terms of how can I lead people if I don't know what I'm doing? You know, I have a very kind of open way of leading, but I'm not being authentic if I'm not saying I'm struggling. And I don't keep pretenses up for very long. But then, like Chloe said, you know, if you're able to open yourself up to your team and say, look, I'm struggling here, not with what we're doing, because I know what we're doing is right, but, you know, how do we get there? Can you give me any, you know, thoughts on that? And then as soon as they see a vulnerability in you, they know it's okay to be vulnerable themselves and they can have those conversations. And it does move down to the children as well. You know, we talk about growth mindset all of the time, and we need to hold ourselves up and say, actually, I've really struggled with this recently. Or I felt like this the first time I did it. It is about being authentic. I think it's crucial. And I think you know yourself a lot more when you're younger. You know, when I think back to when I was in my teens and moving into my early 20s, I gave myself a lot more time to get to know who I was. And I would do a lot more reading, and I was very passionate about, you know, politics and all sorts. And that kind of leaves you for a while, and you become all about everything else and all encompassing. And I think it's really important to listen to young people, because they'll be able to give you your authenticity, because any 4 or 5 year old will tell you if you're not authentic enough. They'll spot it straight away.
They can sniff it out straight away, can't they?
Yeah, they can.
Yeah. I love, you know, in one sense, what you've both talked about there, this sense of vulnerability loop that we can create as well, that when we show and talk about our vulnerability, when we talk authentically and honestly about the things, yeah, I'm struggling with that too. Oh. It gives them permission to do that. But all of that is driven by this sense of where we're trying to go and where we're taking something, because we want to help them in that direction. And in both of your cases, obviously, you know, it's people, it's youth or children that sit at the root of that as well. Great, thank you. And our last letter is W, is wholeness. And I've got another quote for us, because we've had a couple, so let's throw in a few more. So I love the Francis of Assisi quote, for it is in giving that we receive. If you're as old as me, you can remember some primary school hymn which we all kind of sang at the time. But, you know, that's part of a prayer that he talks about. And there's this strange consequence that I've discovered. I don't know if you discovered the same, that when you have a purpose, that means you're giving to others. Now, clearly, if you had a purpose, my purpose is to make millions of pounds, then this one might not resonate with you. But when your purpose is about giving to others, we're demonstrating the African concept of Ubuntu. And Ubuntu is, I am human because of the other. It's about living for other people, not just to, you know, for yourself and for your own selfishness. There is this sense that we do receive a sense of wholeness. So we might be giving out to others, but we receive this sense of wholeness, this sense of we get a gratitude that leads to this kind of inner peace and contentment, and almost this sense of being in flow, being in kind of one with, you know, something a bit bigger and better than perhaps some of the plop of life that we regularly come across. And life just seems to have a bit more joy because of it. Again, am I talking, you know, wild Francis of Assisi stuff, or have you experienced any of this sense of Ubuntu, this sense of being in flow? Chloe, what about you?
Yeah, definitely. I've watched it as well. I love watching the young people once they kind of work out. I've got this one person that honestly it's taken like a year, and they've worked out their purpose. They've worked out what they want to do. And we track their well-being, we track their mental health as well, we talk about it a lot. And most of the young people I work with don't know what they want to do. Their well-being and their mental health is usually affected pretty badly. And the moment we get like a glimmer of, oh yeah, that could be fun, that could be good, and then they start to get it. And it's that the giving yourself to things and others and it proves you have value. Mm. And that's the wholeness, is that you have value in the world. Like, you have something to give. Mm. And I think when you don't have purpose, you don't feel like you have anything to give. It's not about not wanting to give something. It's about thinking that you're not worth anything, or you've got nothing. When they realize that they do have a place, and they do have something they could contribute, it's just the difference is unreal. They just, everything starts to snowball. So you can go like a year with someone where it feels like no progress is made. And then the moment it clicks, it's like 2 months and we're done. I totally agree with that.
Yeah, and I love that, how you've just expanded that. It's this sense then that they have value. That's the sense of joy that we're receiving, because we realize we have value and we're bringing value. We are of value and we bring value. I think that's lovely. Thank you. Joe, what about you? Any sense of seeing Ubuntu, feeling or experiencing Ubuntu, or this sense of value that Chloe's talked about?
Yeah, definitely. I used to get it all of the time. It's lovely hearing Chloe speak, because she works directly with young people. And I think as a head, it's a different journey, because you are not as in touch with the children, and that wholeness doesn't come as frequently as when you're teaching. And you know, I think when you move into leadership, you do miss that. But then the last 3 years have taught me to sort of stand back and watch now. And it's only recently that I've been able to stand back with that sense of wholeness. You know, well done, you've done that. You know, my team have done that without me. You've accomplished it. And it is a feeling, you know, the flow when it's all happening. We had an open evening last year that I had very little to do with, but I had suggestions and kind of said, okay, I'm going to leave it up to you, which is terrifying sometimes as a leader, because you've got 120 parents coming in and you're thinking, okay, I've left it. I've moved away and I've seen what people can do. And then I stood back in the middle of the midst of everything that was going on and just kind of said, yeah, look, it's all happening without me. And that gives me an enormous sense of wholeness. And it's giving to others and saying, oh, you know, I've got faith in you. I know you can do this. And then you receive that sort of feeling back, which is wonderful. And then you watch them do that with their own children in their class and you know, you've got it.
Yeah, and just seeing that impact, I guess it's an element of pay it forward as well, isn't it? As you invest in them, you get this sense of wholeness back. As they then pay it forward to others, they get that sense back. But it also then comes back to you, because you think, oh, actually, I've helped them and then they're helping others. And you almost get that, you know, you get the double wind of it as well, don't you, in doing that? And
what I noticed with Chloe is, and the same with myself, is you feel it, but you aren't necessarily telling everybody about it. And I think sometimes leadership is about just being quiet and going, there it is, there's that moment, there's that young person who's moved their life on, or there's that moment where that member of staff has finally gone, do you know what, I'm going to do that. And you think, yes, I've been working on that for a year. And off they go. And it's a very quiet thing to me. It's not I need to go and post it on a media site or anything else. It's a very reflective, quiet, yes, there it is. And I think if you're in the midst of things, you can sometimes forget to really notice those moments.
Yeah, I think there's a really good and valid point there, Jo. And, you know, one of the things I want leaders to understand, and we'll just talk about this as we draw our podcast to a close, around how you maintain your purpose. And I think that's a really important part of that. The ability to make time just to stop in those moments and just to feel it, be in the now of that moment, as you say, not put it on social media, because it probably wouldn't be appropriate anyway, but just to remind yourself and just reflect. We don't do these things to get that feeling. It is a feeling that comes from it, but just to be able to feel that feeling and not to be moving so fast paced that we sometimes miss these elements, because that will be part of helping us maintain our purpose. Because we, you know, I said earlier about that's what makes your heart beat more, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. The passion. And when we get that feeling of, yeah, that young person has clicked, this child has done this, this member of staff, this adult has, we've just achieved this performance element, whatever your organization does as its purpose, just to spot those and just enjoy those in that moment is a key part. Just as we draw the podcast towards a close, we're just going to just spend a moment thinking about how we maintain purpose. And then I'm going to ask you guys for your top tip for purpose for our listeners. But so we just talked about that, you know, spotting those moments to enjoy them, which will help us maintain that. But is there anything else, Chloe, for you that helps you maintain purpose, either for you or for the organization?
I think reflection is the big one. And that's what I've learned this year, definitely, is that, I say this year, we're only like 6 days in, aren't we? I meant last year. that's for me the bit that I've learned is that I am reflective as a person, and I feel things very acutely, and I need to find a space for myself to do that. And I think what we found as an organisation as well is that we need to do that together as well. And we've put stuff in place for all of us to be able to do that and to be able to kind of express how we're feeling and to express that vulnerability that we talked about earlier in a safe place. I think without that, everything would get so overwhelming sometimes, particularly with everything that's been going on, that you would get lost and it would get muddy. But we've really worked hard in the last year for individuals and for us as an organisation to really take moments to celebrate and then also to talk about the struggles and to talk about what is hard so that we don't all get lost without our compass still there, hopefully.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you, Chloe. Jo, what about you? Is there anything else that you think for our listeners would help them to maintain purpose, either as coaching, great, yeah.
To be honest, this sounds like a really awful kind of old. Basically, for me, it's been transformational just because it makes me stop and reflect. And my brain moves so quickly that even if I take the dogs for a walk or I try and do some meditation or I'll sit and do some yoga, I'm just one of those people where my head is, you know, ping-ponging all over the place. I find that coaching helps me pull everything out and then I go for a walk and then I can reflect because my job is so intense and there are so many pressures that I don't realize are driving, you know, different emotions in me, that for me coaching is transformational, and I put it in my school development plan forevermore, and it's become part of our whole school development. So I would say, yeah, coaching, stopping, letting somebody unpick all of those things for you and then go and reflect.
Yeah, that's great. And yeah, I mean, I will obviously constantly advocate coaching. I think it's really, really key. And I think one of the advantages is that there's somebody there. So you're having a meeting with somebody. So it makes you do it, because otherwise other pressures will pull that time away, isn't it? But also, as you say, it's someone that's there to just help you unpick and gain a clarity, but also just to continue to help you to maintain that purpose and that reflection. So yeah, great. Thank you for sharing that. Top tip from Jo there around maintaining is get some coaching. If you want any...
I'm not on commission.
No, Jo's not on commission, but if you do want any advice, do come and talk to us at Everyday Leader and we'll tell you the sort of things to look out for good coaching. Great. Well, it's been fantastic working with you two today in the Leadership Lounge. And so we're at the point at the end. All good things must come to an end, sadly. It includes our podcast. And we end it always with your top tip. And by me talking now, it gives you a few more moments just to think, what would my top tip be? What from all of the stuff we've talked around today around the power of purpose would I want leaders to take away with them today? And I'm going to ask each of you, and I'll share one as well, as to what that would be. So, Chloe, if we start with you, what would your top tip be for people around discovering this power of purpose?
Mine would definitely be, it might not be for leaders so much, but for everyone, it would be to do stuff, to engage in things, get involved, take opportunities. I think that was four ways of saying the same thing. but perhaps for leaders, it would, what we try to do is create those opportunities and create different things that people can engage in and discover a bit about themselves. And I think for me, that would be, that's how I've done it. That's how I recommend to anyone I work with.
Brilliant. I love the twofold thing you've talked about there. As leaders, create those opportunities for people to discover their passion and purpose. And as you say, for everyone else, it's about do things that enable you to discover that. Brilliant. Thank you, Chloe. Joe, what about you? What's your top tip for our listeners today in the Leadership Lounge?
I would say to just ask yourself why. Because purpose can become very complicated and it involves lots of different elements in your life. But if you ask yourself why, am I still got my core principles at the heart of what I'm doing here? Then my purpose is behind that. So just why am I doing this? And one of the coaching questions you often ask me is, you know, what would be the impact if I did do something, and what would be the impact if I didn't? Yeah. And why am I doing it? You know, what am I hoping to achieve? And underneath there, if you do lose your purpose, it will be there. You will find it.
Yeah, brilliant. So you've managed to float a couple in there, actually. And there's this concept of really just asking yourself, so why am I doing this? What would happen if I did? What would happen if I didn't? And to help you discover that. And then that second one, which I think is really important, you sneak in. So I'm absolutely giving you permission to sneak it in, which is this sense that actually your why, your purpose is probably there, even if you can't see it. But it is just about taking that time and not to panic. It is there. So thank you, Joe. My last one to add to your two brilliant ones as well, from both of you, is just this sense of, if you're trying to discover your purpose, it's just look at what are you passionate about. When you are getting those experiences that Chloe talked about, what makes your heart beat a little bit faster? What gives you this sense of joy as you do it? And that may be an indicator as where you might find this sense of purpose for yourself. Look at your passions, look at your heartbeat, look at the sense of joy, and that might be where to start looking for your purpose. Great. Well, thank you, Chloe and Joe, for your fantastic involvement today in the Leadership Lounge. It's been a joy to spend time with you together. To our listeners, thank you for joining us too. We hope you've enjoyed time in the Leadership Lounge, and we look forward to joining you again next month. So thank you. Thank you, Chloe. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, listeners. And we'll see you all again next month.